Welcome to the second half of the video about GPU Visualizer. It is a part of a bigger series about graphics profiling in Unreal Engine 4. If you know what a GPU Visualizer is and how to run it, you can easily skip the first half and continue with watching the current video. But still, I recommend checking out the entire series about GPU profiling. As I said before, I made quite a lot of research when it comes to explaining the rendering pipeline in Unreal Engine 4. So, in this video, you can find an explanation for the majority of rendering passes, what they are, what affects their cost, and what are the opportunities for optimization in your quality settings and in your content. Now, I understand this is a lot of information, so while I recommend watching through the entire video, I include links to particular slides in the description. So, if you're interested in translucency or compute light grid passes, just go to the description and click on the link. Many of you may also prefer to have this kind of information in a text form, because text is easier to browse when it comes to technical information. So this is what I plan to release at some point on my Gumroad, a small ebook or a PDF file, with information compiled from all these four parts of this tutorial series. So let's begin with explaining what do we call a pass in rendering pipeline. A pass is a set of draw calls. And a draw call is a command from the CPU to control the GPU. For example, render a mesh, change the material, then render a different mesh. As you can imagine, not every pass requires the full shader. The full shader that you edit with nodes. Basically, only translucency and base pass uses this information. While many other passes, like casting shadows, can very well go without using any materials. There are also passes like post-processing that work on the entire screen without touching geometry at all. So what can affect the cost of a pass? I'd recommend to look at its input and its output. If something takes in the screen, the G-buffer, but not any geometry, like the post-process does, then obviously it will be pixel bound, it will be working on pixels. It won't be affected by the amount of triangles in your scene or some other optimization issues of your meshes. And the same goes for ambient occlusion. That's why I recommend to read about how the engine works, not just look at the symptoms, because by knowing how ambient occlusion works, how it is done in Unreal, you will know that geometry doesn't do anything when it comes to its cost, because ambient occlusion is a post-process operation that's using the hierarchical Z-buffer and the G-buffer, for example, normals. While the base pass, which is responsible, for example, for reading the information from the shaders, the textures, and writing it to the G-buffer, obviously is dependent on the complexity of meshes and shaders, but it also writes to the buffer, so the heavier the resolution of your screen, the longer the base pass will take to render. It may seem complicated, but I hope it will be clear when I go through the particular passes. Let me begin with lighting passes, because probably they will be the most heavy part in your scene unless you go crazy with geometry or you have some other optimization issues like particles. The mysterious light composition task's pre-lighting. It's responsible for the deferred decals, which I don't use here, but also for ambient occlusion. That's interesting to know, because you may think that ambient occlusion is a post-process operation. Yes, it is, but it's not in the post-processing category here. Instead, you can find it in light composition tasks. The name of the pass has also some additional information. For example, here it is the full resolution that the ambient occlusion was rendered in, and also the half resolution, which is basically how ambient occlusion is done usually for performance reasons. The cost of this pass is mostly affected by rendering resolution. On the right, I will place the major factors that affect the cost of particular passes, beginning from the most heavy ones to the ones that also matter, but not as much. So the rendering resolution is the biggest factor here, contributing to the cost. You can also control ambient occlusion radius and fadeout distance. As I change the radius, you can see the effect changing. The intensity doesn't have any influence on performance, but radius does. And in advanced, I can also set fadeout distance. So here it affects also the sphere, but as the fadeout distance decreases, it starts to affect only the nearest plane, which is also good for performance in light composition tasks. So the pass has also to do with decals. The greater the number of decals, and we're not talking debuffer decals here, but the standard ones, the longer it takes to compute it. Composition after lighting. This pass is responsible only for subsurface scattering now, in Unreal 4.16. In stat GPU, it's called composition post-lighting. This is for the newer kind of subsurface scattering available in Unreal. So, not the basic one, but the one called subsurface profile. To reduce the cost of this particular pass, you basically have to limit the amount of objects and their screen space size that use subsurface scattering. Or whenever you can, use the fake one or disable it, especially with level of details. Compute light grid. What it does is checking if the lights are needed for rendering of the current view. It's needed for forward shading. As I mentioned in part 2 of this tutorial, two methods of rendering lighting in Unreal, and both of them work simultaneously with the deferred lighting in default settings taking care of opaque meshes and masked meshes, while forward being used for lit translucency, like particles or glass or something like that. So this pass ensures that only relevant lights are considered for lighting, just to save you on computation time. Its cost is affected on the number of lights you place in your scene, movable lights. So if this is an issue for you, probably especially in VR or with forward renderer, then just reduce the number of dynamic lights, movable lights, converting them to static, or just getting rid of them. Now, there is this huge pass of lights, which is split further into non-shadowed lights, indirect lighting, which is the LPV, and shadowed lights. All the lights that have shadow casting disabled and are movable or stationary can be found here, joined into a single big chunk of standard deferred lighting. You can't find a particular movable light that doesn't cast shadows. But in shadowed lights, you can find each light being shown separately, together with the cost of each light's shadow. Non-shadowed and shadowed lights use deferred lighting by default. Deferred lighting is working on the buffers that are collected by the base pass. So if you will see normals here and the scene depth, then this is the information that is enough to perform deferred non-shadowed lighting. As we can see in optimization view modes, light complexity, each light has its radius, and when it comes to cost of rendering a non-shadowed light, the cost is counted in screen space. So the bigger the screen area light covers, the bigger the cost. These lamps are particularly heavy here because they cover the entire screen. As I move further away, then they just cover smaller and smaller area of the screen, with the landscape being lit only by a single skylight probably, or a directional. Static lights that don't count here, because they're just baked light maps. They are not considered being lights anymore. They're just a baked information. But movable lights do, and the more of them you have, the bigger the cost. But also remember that point lights and spotlights that are non-shadowed and small in radius, they can be actually very cheap to render. This is what deferred rendering is for. And you can find scenes where, for example, you have particles carrying lights with each particle. So as you can see, when the radius is small, the cost won't be heavy. The amount of pixels to be shaded with, to be lit with this current light is actually quite small. There is also another trick I want to show you quickly, because I want to focus on explaining the passes, not on optimization here. In normal settings, you have this option enabled by default, which is use inverse squared falloff. And while this looks quite nice and is probably physical, you have to use very huge amounts of intensity and quite a huge radius to reach the area that you're interested in. So as you can see, the area is big, while the result is not so visible. You can change it, you can disable this inverse squared falloff and specify your own falloff exponent. 8 is most similar to it, but you can use smaller intensity now. Okay, but you can also use, for example, 4 or 2. And as you can see, the same radius gives us much bigger range of the light. So I can now decrease the radius 300 and still have a similar effect. Of course, the fall off of the light is not quite good, but it may be enough. It may be a fine compromise for you. So the cost of non-shadowed lights is mostly affected by rendering resolution. The number of movable and stationary lights also count, and the radius of lights is important. Now, shadowed lights are more complicated, because they also have this part that non-shadowed lights have, the part that reaches the scene actually, but first they have to calculate the shadow. And to calculate the shadow, they have to render the geometry from their point of view and save them as a shadow map. So a shadow map is a texture, and the meshes, the more complex they are, the more triangles they have, the bigger the cost of rendering their shadow. So the same things matter that mattered in non-shadowed lights, which is rendering resolution of the game, number of movable and stationary lights that cast shadows, the radius of these lights, and here it's especially important to reduce the radius of shadowed lights. Because look at it that way. Here we have our light. The cone of the spotlight is quite big, and the attenuation radius is quite big. So what happens is that the light hits many, many objects, almost the 1/3 of the building, and uses them to cast shadows. Now, if we reduced this cone, and if we reduce the attenuation radius to something like that, then only this part of geometry will be used to cast shadows. So it can be a huge save, a huge performance saving. Also, wherever you can, just disable casting dynamic shadows here. Maybe for some faraway lights, you will notice almost no difference. Here it matters, but for example for this light, I probably can just disable dynamic shadows and decrease its radius. Like that. It should look similar. So for shadowed lights, check not only the lights themselves, but also the objects that they can affect. Filter translucent volume. I will start with a quote from Unreal documentation. Quote, "Lit translucency gets most of its lighting through a series of cascaded volume textures oriented around the view frustum." End quote. What it means is that lighting for translucent objects is not computed directly. Instead, a grid is calculated from the view of the camera that is split according to the depth of the scene, the distance from the camera, and you can see the effect when I open the opaque material and change its blend mode to translucent. What happened is that the object now has more simplified lighting, much more simplified actually. In this place it looks quite strange. And it's not only because of the shading mode that changed from deferred rendering to forward rendering, but also because of this volumetric lighting grid. In the translucency tab, inside of a material, you can see the lighting mode, and it's set to volumetric directional. This ensures that the material is making use of this cheap way to calculate lighting. The lighting is being calculated into a volume. It's affected by the number of movable lights and also by the number of shadow casting lights. ShadowDepths, one of the passes used to calculate shadows, the other being shadow projection. So ShadowDepths is generation of depth maps for shadow casting lights. Depth maps are the textures that are like the scene depth from the viewpoint of particular light. Imagine light being a camera and you calculate the depth of each pixel from this light. This information is used later to predict if a particular part of the scene is in this light's shadow or it can be lit. Now the cost of it is mostly affected by the number and the range of shadow casting lights. Also what matters is number and triangle count of movable shadow casting objects. So depending on the combination, you can have static meshes and static lights, then the cost is zero because they are not calculated as lights, they are baked. But you can also have, for example, stationary or movable lights and static and movable objects. And both of these combinations will lead to generating shadows from these objects in the range of the particular light. You can also affect it by changing shadow quality. Here I have my crisp shadow, but I can enter sg.shadowQuality and, for example, something from 0, which is no shadows, up to 4, which is full quality. Let me go with 1. And now you can see that the shadows are quite jagged, lacking the resolution somehow. I can change it all the way up to 4. And now they are super crisp, but the resolution of the depth maps increased. So the cost of rendering and storing them and reading them back also increased. Shadow projection. Shadow projection is final rendering of the shadow. So it takes the depth map and renders it back onto the scene. Imagine it like taking the depth map and behaving like a projector. In GPU visualizer, it's shown per particular light in the light category. So unlike shadow depths, in shadow projection, what also matters is the final rendering resolution of the game. Let's proceed to geometry, HZB and base pass. Chronologically, rendering a frame starts with a prepass. Of course, unless you have the prepass disabled at all. So the prepass is rendering of the scene's depth very early in the pipeline. You can use the information for debuffer decals and for occlusion culling, which is hiding the objects behind other objects for performance reasons. By going into project settings, engine, rendering, optimizations, and early ZPass, you can change the setting to include masked meshes or just opaque meshes. Because the PrePass by default takes only opaque meshes and doesn't make use of the texture that is used as a mask for this particular material of the final shader opacity mask output. But you can enable it if you find it necessary, or you can disable the PrePass at all if you don't use debuffer decals. The cost is affected mostly by the triangle count of opaque objects in total, but it also depends on early Z setting I mentioned. When you use mask materials with it, then of course overdraw of next polygons in view, one behind each other, may be a problem, like in foliage for example. Now the mysterious HZB setup mips. What is the HZB pass we can find in our visualizer and which often takes a huge amount of the frame cost? Well, basically, don't worry about this cost. If you're checking it in editor, then you can see numbers like 4 or 5 milliseconds, which is absolutely ridiculous. When you run an actual build and look at stat GPU or the console output, you will see that it will take from 0.1 to half a millisecond, maybe up to 1 millisecond at worst. So what it is? HZB is hierarchical Z buffer. It's the depth of the scene rendered into a buffer, so a full screen texture. Its layout is made in such a fashion that it can be used for occlusion culling very efficiently, and the basic occlusion culling method used in Unreal is based on this hierarchical Z buffer, and it's also used by screen space ray tracing, so the technique that is used by reflections and ambient occlusion. The cost of HZB is strictly dependent on the rendering resolution. Some other factors matter, but completely not as much as the pure rendering resolution of your game. Now, the base pass. The base pass is probably one of the most important ones, because it takes your shaders that you made in Material Editor, makes all the calculations, and outputs the resulting values like roughness, final metallic, final normal, subsurface scattering profile, specular. It saves them into so-called G-buffers. So G-buffers are full screen textures and they store all this information to be used later, for example by deferred rendering, basically by all the subsequent composition. When you are using deferred rendering, you need to rely on G-buffer to provide the normal, the depth, and the roughness of this particular pixel. So it has quite a lot of work. It means that it runs the node-based part of the shaders, as well as other things. And its cost depends on resolution, number of objects, because it affects the number of draw calls. I should also mention the number of separate materials used in the scene, or their instances. Shader complexity, so how many and how heavy nodes you have in your shaders. The number of decals, which can be surprising, for example we're not thinking about it, and then we are hit by the amount of decals in our scene. And the triangle count of our meshes. But that's not all that the base pass has to do. It does a lot more. For example, it reads static lighting from light maps, from indirect lighting caches, and it saves them to the G-buffer also, mixed with the diffuse. So watch bandwidth, watch how heavy you are on the memory, because light maps are textures too. You may not think about them, you may think that you are okay with the resolution of the textures, and then you have a lot of objects with heavy light maps, big resolutions, and suddenly you may be encountering some memory problems. It also applies debuffer decals, so it gathers the surrounding debuffer decals and projects them into objects. Then it applies fog and calculates final velocity. So it reads the information given by the past render velocities and calculates the final one. So I mentioned this bandwidth issue and memory issues. You can press tilde and enter stat RHI, enter. You can see the render target memory being over 1 GB. Texture memory is quite small here in the scene, fortunately. And there are 11 million triangles drawn. Because this is not only the triangles that you can see in your 3D package. If I decrease the rendering resolution by typing R screen percentage 20. Sorry, let me play the game. Okay, now it renders in quite a low resolution. R screen percentage 10. As you can see, this information here is not so reliable because the cost in the editor also affects the cost in the running game. So what I need to do is to open a build. Then in the build, I can press stat RHI. And now I have the real amount of memory used, 575 megabytes for just storing the GBuffer. Now I can change R screen percentage to 20. And you can see the buffer resolution dropping to 219 megabytes. If the screen percentage was 5%, you can see after a while that it dropped to 150 megabytes. Now obviously resolutions like 4K will be a massacre in the term of storage in the video RAM, because now it reached almost the maximum of the memory I have on my card, and it stutters very badly. I also heard recommendations about changing R.SceneColor format, which is the format of the image in which GBuffer is stored. Still, I hadn't tried myself. If you are using forward renderer that is recommended for VR scenes, then the lighting goes here too. You won't see the lighting in the lighting category, you will see it affecting the base pass. So obviously, it becomes affected by number and range of movable and stationary lights. Translucency. Translucency is one big category that combines the total cost of shaders and of lighting of translucent materials. In StatGPU, it's fortunately split into translucency and translucent lighting. Its cost is affected by rendering resolution, but we are dealing with translucency here, so also by the total area of translucent polygons and their overdraw. So one polygon being behind another and another that is also translucent, so their cost sums up. As I mentioned in part 2, there is a mode that lets you check the overdraw of polygons. If you enabled surface forward shading type of lighting in your material, then the number of lights also affects this pass. Let's proceed with remaining passes. Particle simulation and injection. Particle simulation on the GPU is the cost that is calculated here. So only if you enabled GPU sprites in your particle emitter, then it will affect this particular pass. The cost is affected by the number of particles spawned by such emitters, and if you enabled collision module or you didn't, because the collision with GPU sprites is calculated from the screen space data, like ZDEV and such. So obviously, the bigger the amount of particles that have to collide, then the bigger the cost of this particular pass. Remember, you can use particle level of detail to manage the amount of particles being spawned. Post-processing. This pass is responsible for many things that occur in screen space, like anti-aliasing, because unless you are doing VR, you will rely on temporal or FXAA anti-aliasing, with temporal being the default, better looking but heavier one. Depth of field is done here, lens flares, bloom, auto exposure, which is the eye adaptation, and tone mapping, as well as color grading, which is responsible for the final look of the colors, contrast, and so on. So the cost is most obviously affected by rendering resolution of your game. Also, number and quality of post-processing features count, because you can enable all this stuff at once, lens flares, depth of field, and so on, but each of them has their cost, and in case of depth of field and lens flares, it can be quite big. You can also change the anti-aliasing to FXAA for lower quality, but better performance. And the number and complexity of so-called blendables matters. Blendables are post-processing shaders, just the materials you can use to control the final look of your image. Reflection environment. It reads and blends reflection captures into a full screen reflection buffer. So, in your scene, you may have various so-called reflection capture actors, like box reflection capture or screen reflection capture. But what's important to know is they have their radius, and this radius quite heavily affects the cost of calculating reflection pass. When you enter lit and change it to reflections, you can see it. And you can see how this particular capture sphere affects the final reflection buffer, which is later used by materials when doing reflections, specular part of the shading. You may have overlapping reflection actors, but I recommend to have one big one, for example 3000, that covers the big area, and only then place small reflection actors whenever you need them. For example, for this particular air conditioner, you may have a specific actor of a radius 100. And the less of them are overlapping and the lower their radius, the better. The final rendering resolution of your game also matters here. Render velocities. It takes the velocity of each moving vertex and saves it into the motion blur velocity buffer. So now, in this crazy example, you can see asteroids moving around. If I freeze the image, it can be visible that there is a motion blur, and the render velocities pass is made particularly for this motion blur effect. And you can't disable it, from what I know. It's affected by the number of moving objects and the triangle count of these objects. With a small number of asteroids, the render velocities pass is taking below 1 millisecond. As I increase the number of the objects, it goes up to 2 or 3 milliseconds now, but if I used an object that has level of detail instead of the heavy one, you can see the render velocities going back into 0.7 milliseconds. So much, much better. it's clearly affected by the triangle count of the moving objects. Screen space reflections. This is an addition to the former reflections path. It's for dynamic reflections, real-time dynamic reflections. They are done in post-process using a screen space ray tracing technique, and their cost is affected by the rendering resolution of your game, but also by quality settings. Not only we have R.SSR quality, ranging from 0 to 4, but we can also specify the maximum roughness for which these reflections happen, because their cost increases as the roughness increases. They have to cover a wider area. Sharp reflections are just easier to calculate. So you can specify that, for example, over 0.3 of roughness, they're just are not used. There's a fallback to default captured reflections. And that's it. We have gone through the majority of passes you can find in Unreal rendering pipeline. I hope I explained them well. I tried to double check everything because, you know, you can find a lot of information on the internet, but my main reason for doing this tutorial was to find these things for sure. I browsed source code, I read source, also asked some people, especially thanks for Christian Gawai and Leszek Godlewski for helping me with this, and I encourage you to do your own experiments. There is a site that is tremendously helpful with this. It's cosmocleaner.de/onsoft/ue4cvarbrowser.html. It's called UE4 Console Variables and Commands. This website allows you to browse and find every console command that is available in Unreal and in build development builds. For example, when you are wondering about HZB, you can type in HZB and find that it can be disabled by using art.hzbocclusion spacebar 0. Another site is scalability reference in official Unreal Engine documentation. The scalability reference is showing us various ways to change the quality of specific features like shadow casting or the feature I used a lot here, resolution scale, which changes the rendering resolution of your game, allowing to test if you are pixel bound or not. The third, final website I want to recommend is an amazing in-depth article by Adrian Courage called Doom 2016 Graphics Study. It's a great write-up on the general rendering of a modern game. You have all the techniques described in detail. Here you can see the velocity map we discussed earlier. We also have occlusion queries, which are the alternative to HZB occlusion in Unreal Engine. And the forward rendering done in the same manner that is now done in the forward renderer in Unreal, that you can choose when doing a VR project, but not only. As you can see, Doom is using it as a default technique of lighting. So in general, I encourage you to look for such materials, to read papers from GDC, Game Developers Conference. There's an abundance of such materials on the internet. Just be interested in rendering pipelines, search, ask on Reddit, on Facebook groups and other places. I think that many technical artists and rendering programmers will be very keen to share such materials with you and say what they used when they were learning such stuff. Thank you very much for watching this tutorial. If you found it helpful, I will be grateful if you shared this material with others. And let's have a nice discussion in the comments. Try this stuff in your projects, let me know, and let the others know what you found. And see you next time. Bye.